Hello students, I am Preeti ma'am, your science teacher, and going to teach you your first chapter, Matter in Our Surroundings. Topics that we are going to cover: definition of matter, characteristics of particles of matter, classification of matter, and properties of the matter. Matter. Anything that occupies space and has mass is called matter. Like, for example, air and water, hydrogen, oxygen, sugar, sand, silver, steel, copper, coal, iron, wood, ice, alcohol, milk, oil, kerosene, petrol, and many such examples we can give. All these are different kinds of matter. Why? Because all of them occupy space and has mass. Here is a beautiful picture. You can see the picture of a leaf over here. Anything around us is made up of tiny particles. Our body is also made up of particles. Chair, table, book, there are many examples that we can give. The number of particles in everything is, however, very large. A simple example. You can see a raindrop over here. It contains about 10 to the power of 21 particles of water. Particles which make up matter are so small that we cannot see them even through a highly powered microscope. Even without seeing them, we have certain evidence which tells us that all the things are made up of tiny particles. The tiny particles which make up matter are atoms or molecules. Matter. Anything that occupies space and has mass is called matter. Like I gave you earlier many examples, some of the examples are given over here: air, hydrogen, sugar, sand, silver, steel, iron, wood, carbon dioxide, steam, milk, oil. All these are examples. Matter can be classified in a number of ways. Our Indian philosophers said that all matters, or living things or non-living, are made up of five basic elements, panchatattva, like air, earth, fire, sky, and water. Agni, prithvi, akash, jal, and vayu. Modern day scientists classify matter into two ways: on the basis of physical properties and on the basis of chemical properties. On the basis of physical properties, matter is classified as solids, liquids, and gases. And on the basis of chemical properties, matter is classified as elements, compounds, and mixture. Dissolving a solid in liquid. Example is given over here: potassium permanganate in water and sugar in water. Potassium permanganate is purple colored solid substance. Here a beautiful picture is given. You can see over here it is a purple color solid substance, and water is colorless over here. We will first study the dissolving of potassium permanganate in water. When the crystal of potassium permanganate is placed in a beaker of water, slowly it turns purple due to its own, even without stirring. The spreading of purple color of potassium permanganate in the whole water of beaker, I will explain you now. Both potassium permanganate crystals and water are made up of very tiny particles. The particles of potassium permanganate are purple colored, whereas the particles of water are colorless. When the potassium permanganate crystal is put in water, its particles separate from one another. These purple colored particles of potassium permanganate spreads throughout the water, making the whole water purple. Actually, on dissolving, the particles of potassium permanganate get into spaces between the particles of water. Here, one more example is given over here. This is the character of particles of matter. First character, there are four characters that we are going to study. But the very first character, the particles of matter are very, very, very small. One beautiful experiment is given over here. The very, very small size of the particles of matter with an experiment of potassium permanganate in water. Potassium permanganate is a kind of matter. We will take 2 to 3 small crystals of potassium permanganate and dissolve it in 100 ml water in a beaker. We will get a deep purple colored solution of potassium permanganate in water, like you can see over here. Take 10 ml of deep purpled colored solution of potassium permanganate from the first beaker and mix it with 90 ml of water present in the second beaker to dilute it. Due to this dilution, the color of potassium permanganate solution in the second beaker becomes a bit lighter. Now we will again take 10 ml from this solution of the second beaker and mix it with 90 ml of water which is present in the third beaker to dilute it further. The color of the solution will become still lighter. We will keep on diluting the solution, potassium permanganate solution, like this a number of times. In this way, we will get a very dilute solution of potassium permanganate in water, but the water is still colored, say very light pink in color. This experiment shows that just 2 or 3 tiny crystals of potassium permanganate can impart color to the large volume of water. From this observation, we conclude that each potassium permanganate crystal itself must be made up of millions of small particles which keep on spreading and imparting color to more and more of water on dilution. The next character of water, matter. The particles of matter have space between them. The spaces between the particles of matter also we can explain with an example. Say example of water and sugar. What will we do? We will take about 100 ml of water in a beaker. We will mark the level of the water. Like here we have marked over here, level of water with a marker pen. Also take 50 grams of sugar. 50 grams of sugar. Now add this 50 gram of sugar inside the water in the beaker. Dissolve it by stirring it with the glass rod. When all the sugar has dissolved, we get a sugar solution. When we observe the level of sugar solution in the beaker, we will find that the level of the sugar solution in the beaker is at the same mark where the level was initially in the beaker. This means that even after dissolving 50 grams of sugar in 100 ml of water, the volume has not increased. The fact that there is no change in volume on dissolving sugar in water, it tells us that there are spaces between the particles of matter. The particles in water are not tightly packed. They are somewhat loose, having spaces between them. The third characteristics of matter. Particles of matter are continuously moving. The best evidence that particles of matter are continuously moving comes from the studies of diffusion. When we light an incense stick, agarbatti, in one corner of a room, its fragrance, its smell, its pleasant smell spreads in the whole room quickly. The burning of incense stick produces gases or vapors having pleasant smell. The particles of gases produced by burning of incense stick moves rapidly in all the direction, mixes with the moving particles of air in the room and reach every part of the room quickly. When the gaseous particles from incense stick reach our nose, we smell the fragrance. So on observation that the fragrance of burning stick steadies or spreads in the entire room very quickly tells us that the particles of matter are constantly moving. The particle of matter attract each other. There are some forces of attraction between the particles of matter which binds them together. The force of attraction between the particles of the same substance, it is known as cohesion. 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 The force of attraction is different in the particles of different kinds of matter. If we take a piece of chalk, a cube of ice, and an iron nail and beat them with hammer, we will find that it is very easy to break a chalk into smaller pieces. It requires much less force, it requires more force to break a cube of ice. Whereas the iron nail does not break at even very large force. This shows that the force of attraction between the particles of chalk is quite weak. The force of attraction between the particle of ice is a bit stronger. Whereas the particles or the force of attraction between the particles of iron nail is very, very, very strong. The force of attraction is maximum in the particles of solid matter and minimum in the particles of the gaseous matter. Characteristics of particles of matter: rigid and fluid. A stone is rigid because it is unbendingly or inflexible. Fluid means a material which can flow easily. A material which can flow easily and requires a vessel or a container to be kept. Water is an example. Water is a fluid because if we pour water on the top of the table, it flows over the surface of the table. Water, milk, chlorine gas, all these are examples of fluids. Solid is a rigid. It is a rigid form of matter. Solids do not require a container to keep them. A brick and a log of wood. We can give such examples of solid. A liquid is a fluid form of matter which occupies the lower part of the container in which it is kept. A liquid does not fill the whole container. Being fluid, liquids require a container to keep them. A liquid has a well-defined surface. So, a liquid can be kept in an open container. A liquid will not escape from the open container by itself. Water and milk are also common examples of liquid around us. A gas is a fluid form of water which fills the whole container in which it is kept. Being fluids, gases also require a container to keep them. A gas does not have free surface. So, a gas has to be kept in a closed container. A gas will escape if kept in an open container. This is why gases are usually kept in airtight containers or airtight cylinders. Best example, cooking gas, LPG. It is kept in airtight cylinders. Right? All these things I explained to you. A liquid is a fluid form of water which occupies the lower part of the container in which it is kept. And a gaseous is fluid form of matter which fills up the whole container in which it is kept. On the basis of physical states, all matter can be classified into three groups: solids, liquids and gases. Sugar, sand, iron, wood, rock, minerals, ice, many examples of solids. Whereas water, milk, oil, kerosene, petrol, alcohol, these are all the examples of liquids.
air, oxygen, hydrogen, carbon dioxide, steam, many such examples of gases. In other words, we can say that matter exists in three physical states: solid, liquids, and gases. Let us study the properties of each. The properties of solids: ice, wood, coal, stone, iron, brick, many examples of common solids around us. Some of the characteristic properties are listed over here. Solids, they have fixed shape and fixed volume. Like example, brick, it has a fixed shape. Solids cannot be compressed. We cannot compress them much. We cannot push them. We cannot compress them and make it fill up in the whole container. Solids have high densities. They are quite heavy. Solids, they do not fill the container completely. And they do not flow also. Let us study some of the physical properties of liquids now. Water, milk, fruit juices, ink, groundnut oil, kerosene, petrol, diesel. These are some of the examples, common examples of liquids. Some of the characteristics of liquids are. Liquids have fixed volume, but they have no fixed shape. They take up the shape of the container in which it is kept. Whatever it is, it may be jug, it may be glass, it may be bowl. In whatever we keep it, it takes up its space. Like solids, liquids cannot be compressed. We cannot compress them. We cannot compress it. Liquids have moderate to high densities. They are heavy, but they are not as heavy as the solids. They are usually less dense than solids. And they do not fill their container completely. And lastly, liquids generally flow easily. Some of the properties of gases: air, oxygen, hydrogen, carbon dioxide, nitrogen, and steam. Many such examples of common gases. Let us study the characteristic properties of some of the gases. Gases have neither a fixed shape nor a fixed volume. They acquire the shape and volume of the vessel in which they are kept. Gases, they can be compressed easily into very less volume. They have the very low density, means they are very, very, very light in weight. Gases fill the container completely. They occupy the whole of the space. And gases, it flows easily. Here is one of the examples that I have taken to show that solids, liquids cannot be compressed, but gases, it can be compressed easily. We will take 300 ml glass syringes having frictionless pistons. The nozzles of all the syringes are closed by inserting them in a separate rubber cork so as to prevent leakage from this. We'll remove the pistons of all the three syringes. In the first syringe, we will take common salt. Common salt in the first syringe. Then we will insert the pistol back into the syringe. But before putting the piston, we will apply some Vaseline over here for the smooth movement. In the second syringe, we will fill water. You know, water, it is a liquid. Whereas common salt we have taken in this, it is a solid. Liquid. We will insert the piston back into the syringe. Here also. But after applying the Vaseline, remember that. In the third syringe also, we'll do one thing. We'll not fill anything inside. Nothing. Nothing inside. Means if nothing is inside, then what must it be there? Air must be there inside. And what is air? Air is a gas. Now, we will place 100 gram weight on the top of the piston. See, over here we have put, here also, here also, here also. To put pressure on the common salt, water and the air which is filled in them. What will we observe? We will observe that the piston of the first syringe, this one, the piston of the first syringe containing common salt, it does not move down on putting weight. This shows that on applying pressure, the volume of common salt in the syringe does not get reduced. It also means that on applying pressure, the common salt does not get compressed. Since common salt is a solid, so we can say in general that a solid does not get compressed. The second case, the piston of the second syringe. Second syringe contains water. It contains water. It also does not move down on putting weight. This also shows that on applying pressure, the volume of the water in the syringe does not get reduced. This means that on applying pressure, the water does not get compressed. Since water is a liquid, so in general we can say that a liquid does not get compressed on applying pressure. The piston of the third syringe containing air moves down considerably on putting weight. Moves down comes considerably on putting weight. This shows that on applying pressure, the volume of air in the syringe is reduced. This means that on applying pressure, the air gets compressed into a smaller volume. Since air is a gas, so it in general, we can say that air can be compressed easily by applying pressure. Gases, you can see when we blow air in the balloon, the air particles push the balloon walls from inside and exert the pressure on them. This pressure causes the balloon to inflate. It becomes bigger. Thus, a gas exerts pressure on the walls of the container. One more example of gases have high compressibility. They can be compressed into very, very small volumes by applying large pressures. Due to its high compressibility, fairly a very, very large mass of gas can be put inside in a small metal cylinder.
by compression. Such gas cylinders can be transported conveniently from one place to another. The cooking gas, which is the liquefied petroleum gas, which we use in our homes, is a compressed gas. The gas, oxygen gas, supplied to hospitals in cylinders is also compressed in this form. And compressed natural gases, the CNGs, compressed natural gases, in the cylinders is being used increasingly as a fuel in to run vehicles and the buses.